Whiskey Jason here, whiskey from the viewpoint of an American in Germany tasting rare and exotic whiskeys. Today I'm in Ireland. Today I have the Liberator for the second time. This is the small batch double port finish, one of 1,000 bottles. And this is batch one here, 45%. Interesting enough, they actually had a nice little thing here. It used to be, there's a little sticker on here. It used to be 46. But something happened and they put a little sticker on it for 45. I'm not sure if that's even legal. I would have reprinted the label, to be honest. I mean, come on, I can just pull this thing off. Now, me and the Liberator, we're not the best of friends, to be very honest. I'm going to try to be as fair as I can possibly be. The Liberator is basically a new independent bottler. They call themselves a bonder. Thank you to Louise from JJ Corey. Up there in Ireland, and what they do is they buy whiskey and they fill it into different, many, many times, port barrels where they have connections from the family, and then they sell it. So the inaugural release, if I can believe, whiskey base was actually Bushmill juice and a Great Northern distiller's juice. This here is Cooley juice and Great Northern's juice. So I'm going to compare it to something, and I found something out which I thought was very interesting. I'm going to use Ballyhoo. Ballyhoo was a single grain here from Connacht Distillery before they actually produced their own stuff and now releases it. This was something that they did in order to get their distribution up and going, which is fabulous. Now this is 100% single grain. So it's 93% corn, 7% malted barley, and it's made on a column still. Now for me, and this is something I did not know, maybe you can help me out there, are you allowed to call single grain Irish whiskey? I thought Irish whiskey meant a blended whiskey. Now I may be totally wrong. Now I know there's a single pot still, which is of course malted and unmalted barley. And I know there's single pot, single malt, which is 100% malted barley. But I thought that if you have a Irish whiskey, Jameson, you have at least some of the single malt or single pot still in there. Apparently not, because it's just Irish whiskey and it's 100% grain, which I did not know. Shock. All right, so there is a good amount of information on this bottle. Unfortunately, not the information that I want. At least not all the information I want. So 45%, as I mentioned, the sticker on here instead of 46, shame on you, print your labels, please. 1,000 bottles. I do know that I have bottle number 399. Yes, it would have taken probably 2 months to get the new labels done, I understand. Whiskey base number 167622. So what we have here is grain whiskey from Great Northern Distillers, and about 5 years old. And it was actually for about 12 months in a ruby cask, according to Mareike Spitzer here from www.irish-whiskies.de, the German importer for this brand. And then we have single malt, according to Whiskey Base, it's Cooley, between about 14 years of age. And it was for between 9 and 12 months in ruby and in tawny port casks. Very interesting, very interesting. So we had a part that was in ruby port, another part that was in ruby port, and one part that was in tawny port. Now what I want to know, and I do not know, and nowhere can I find this information, is the percentage. How much grain, how much malt? Is it 70-30, is it 20-80, is it 50-50, what is it? So that's something I would have liked to have known. Now I must commend them on two things. I'm not a big fan of the bottle, but hey, some people like this. What I must commend them on is it's non-chilled filtered and it's natural color. Well done, guys. All right. So if I smell it, a little bit of a mineral-like berry moment. And the entire time, there's something in there that really kind of, I don't like. There's something not kosher in here. According to my nose. It's got a sweetness and it's got a fruitiness, but there's a little bit of like a, how can I put this? It's not yeast. I've tasted yeast before. It's more like a truffle type of, all right. I once made cranberry sauce myself. Yay. I don't know if you ever made cranberry sauce yourself, but over here in Germany, we don't have the ocean spray cranberry in the can for Thanksgiving. So Thanksgiving came around, and so I couldn't find the Ocean Spray cranberry sauce, so I tried to make my own. I bought a big bag of cranberries, used half of them, cooked them up, did that terrible stuff. Don't do it. At least I can't do it. I'm not a good cranberry maker, at least with that or sauce. And the other half kind of sat in the corner. I forgot about them. I came back a couple weeks later, and they were a little bit moldy. I'm getting a little bit of this type of truffle moldy type of mushroomy moment here, which I don't think belongs in a whiskey. I come over here to the Ballyhoo, light, bright, very clear, very crisp. I like this more than I should sometimes. 34 euros, 30, 43 euros here. All right, let's try them. For me, there's something off in here. There's an off note. There's a off note. And what's really interesting is a lot of hotness, a lot of heat towards the end. That's that grain. Wow. There's a lot more hotness than there, a lot more heat than there should be after in a product of this quality, at least I think. And the whole time I have something in there which is not exactly what I think should be there. It's a type of dark chocolate. I'm looking for words and expressions and comparisons. A dark chocolate that's gone wrong. There's this foamy chocolate with a lot of air in there. If you just forget it in the drawer for like a year and a half and you come back, and the stale type of meh, and that's what I'm almost getting here. I'm not a fan of this. I'm so sorry. Maurice at the Liberator, he has a seal of his company, proudly wayward since 1661. Well, I can trace my history of my American family back to 1644. I don't put it on any labels. It's just one of the things I just rubs me wrong. All right, so anytime you put an age statement or a year on there, it should have something to do with the whiskey. And not definitely about you or your family or about maybe even your estate. Now, they do have a nice 300-year-old stone warehouse where they put the barrels in there, and they use it now as a rickhouse, as a warehouse. The entranceway is a little bit too small, so many of the bigger butts and so on, they can't even get in there. So they have to use somewhat smaller barrels sometimes. They, of course, could change the building if they wanted to, but God forbid they would do something like that. It's a listed building. No. And so this has a little bit of a uniqueness there. And many people love what Maurice is doing at the Liberator. I personally, I just can't connect. I'm so sorry. If I'm going to connect with the whiskey, it's going to be Ballyhoo. I don't even know if it's on the market anymore. In Germany, we can still buy it. This is for me just like something you'd use in a cranberry mixer. This is just a beautiful, young, crisp, very fresh spirit. The port is lively, very nice whiskey, clear. This is a little bit of a unicorn for me. This is a little bit of a weirdo. What I did not do in my German video, which I'm going to do in my English video, is I'm actually going to dilute it down to under 30%. See if I can locate. Wait a second. This uniqueness of this whiskey here. I did dilute it down to about 40% and got some interesting results, but I did not go all the way down here to about 25%. Cleanse my palate. Soapiness. A little bit of dishwasher detergent here, maybe Tide. That's interesting. It's gone. It's still there a little bit. The heat is definitely gone. That's good. Yeah, there was a light moment there, but it's not as bad. Going back to the normal, I just did that on purpose, so I have a little bit of the normal, the bottle strength. It's got a funk. And the funk is not something I personally like. Other people might actually just fall in love with this and say, the best whiskey ever. There's the funk. And then there's the heat. All right, good. Probably won't be able to buy this anyways, except for in Ireland and in Germany, 1,000 bottles total. D for taste and D for value for money, so sorry. So I would say there is a tawny port from the Liberator, which I decided not to buy. Also with Cooley Juice and NG Great Northern Distillers. The inaugural release is all gone, by the way. And this is Wayward Irish Spirits, by the way, who are making this. They will be using their own grain to actually produce whiskey. They have already at least done the first batch with Great Northern Distilleries, that they actually take their own grain, as in this case, I hope it will be barley. They get it malted, send it over, and they distill their own spirit. By 2024, it should actually be their grain in this glass. They are looking at doing a micro distillery as well. That's going to be very interesting, but not enough to actually support the amount of output that they are planning on doing. So also that is an interesting thing. So it'll be micro distilled their own and source whiskeys from outside. All right, Whiskey Jason here. Whiskey from the viewpoint of an American in Germany. 1,000 bottles, rare and exotic. That's the way that is. I'm sorry, the Liberator is not my cup of tea. Thank you very much for watching. My question is, what other whiskeys do you know of that have a double finish? A double finish in this case would be a tawny and a ruby port finish. I recently did a Glendronach that had a Pedro Ximenez and a red wine cask finish. If you look at Bushmills 16, you will see that it has a port and a sherry finish. These are the so-called double finishes. What other whiskeys do you know with double finishes, and which ones do you like? Thank you very much for watching. Whiskey Jason here. All the best. Thank you very much. Like, subscribe, share, and tell others. Bye-bye.